A lot of folks are not aware. I was on a statin before all of this blood work was done and the discovery of the LP little a. It turns out statins, for most people, they will actually raise your LP little a. For some people, it's 5 or 10%, but for some people, it's as much as 30 or 40%. It could be a drastic increase. So in consultation with my doctor, we decided because we had a target LDL, we needed to get my LDL down, and we also wanted to get my LP little a down, we decided that the appropriate therapeutic for me would be a PCSK9 inhibitor, and in this case, Repatha, which works like similar to a statin in terms of its effect on LDL. It actually, correct me if I'm wrong, Dr. Brewer, but I believe it has a larger impact on LDL lowering than statin generally.
It does.
A lot of people who don't tolerate statins, a lot of their in consultation with their doctors will go on PCSK9. If they are not able to get their LDL to target range, or if they're not tolerating statins, it's used for that. But another really nice thing is that it happens to lower LP little a as well. So, but before I went on PCSK9, we washed out the statin. So I went completely off the statin for 3 months, took another baseline of my LP little a, and interesting, my LP little a went down 5% from that. So now it's a little movement, but I'll take it. It's something. There is some anecdotal research out there, some anecdotal evidence that omega-3s might lower LP little a in some people. And so I went in consultation with my doctor, I went on pretty relatively high dose of omega-3s via fish oil supplement. We targeted a level of 4,000 milligrams of EPA and checked my levels again, and actually it lowered it another 5%. So we had a little bit of movement then. Pretty soon after that, I did go on the PCSK9 inhibitor. That's where I got the really big effect. PCSK9 inhibitor actually dropped my LP little a another 40%. So I'm now at 131 nanomoles per liter. Most of the credit going to PCSK9 inhibitor. That's still high. You know, 75 nanomoles is the target range. Being under that, I'm still high, but I'm 70% elevated instead of being 330% elevated. And based on the research done, it would seem that I would be at a significantly lower risk or hazard ratio, as you would say, based on my new levels of LP little a.
That's very helpful. Let me talk for a few minutes about some of the things that you've raised. So the first was the risk or hazards ratio. Yes. In fact, if we could go back and talk a little bit about the image here that we discussed a few minutes ago. This is risk on the left-hand side. For those of you who are confused, it takes a little bit to understand the concepts and what this is actually telling us. HR stands for hazards ratio, and it's a measurement of risk. If the hazards ratio is 1, it's the experimental group, or the group with LP little a, has the same risk as the group without it. If it's 2, this group has double the risk. If it's 3, it's triple the risk. 4 and 5 times the risk. So here's the other thing to think about. This is levels of LP little a. Blue is a level of LP little a, less than 6.9 up to 6.9. Green is 6.9 to 23.8, and pink is 23.8 and above. Now, so as Chuck mentioned, his was like 250, so 10 times that 23.8. As we've also mentioned, the vast majority of people are in these lower ranges. Let's just call Chuck's range more like a world-class range. With folks that have these smaller numbers, 23.8 up to 50, 70, numbers like that, this is what you tend to see. And that's most of the people in this group, this pink group, had those kind of numbers, unless I'm mistaken. Chuck, if I am, please interrupt and let me know.
Just one point you were comparing. Remember, I'm in nanomoles per liter, and this study did it in milligrams per deciliter. So My level is about 4 times the beginning point of the top level here, being 23.
Okay. Just 4 times rather than 10 times. Anyway, significant increase. And again, I still say that that would put you in more of a world-class number. If you look at these units, milligrams per deciliter, what is it? Is it something like half or more, or at like 30? And then once you get to 40, you get, gosh, another major portion of folks. So it's a skewed curve. And the vast majority of people are going to be, like you said, much, much lower than you. Here's what happens. What happens is if you start managing your blood pressure, your insulin resistance, other risk factors, smoking. You start getting down to these, we're talking about the Framingham, the classic risk factors. Once you start managing those, very significant risk comes back down to very manageable risk or negligible risk. That leaves, again, those folks that have, again, 100, 200. We've had a couple of people on the show. Joe Riley, I think, said he had like 700 or 800. And he did share with us. He had aortic valve calcification. You and I talked about aortic valve before the show. We can bring that up in a few minutes. But as you said, the aortic valve business is something that you're going to see with people that have other genetic risk factors and or people like you that have world-class problems in terms of LP little a. So it gets back to the point, and I'll repeat this often. I repeated this with you, but prior to the discussion, and that is, if you manage all of your other risk factors, you do tend to manage LP little a. And you very gentle, perhaps overly gentle with me to say, what you should have said was, hey, doc, you know, I'm a poster boy for world-class levels, and we need more than that. Thank you for bringing that up. And I think I wanted to bring that up for the audience as well. Again, I'll say multiple times, the reason that most docs have ignored it is, number one, we didn't have a treatment for it. And number two, it had to do with managing all the other risk factors. I think maybe I've butchered that point up trying to hammer it home. You have any clarification for me, Chuck?
No, I think that's very true. You know, people, because that's the big question. You know, again, a lot of doctors saying, don't test for it. There's nothing you can do. Well, there is a lot you can do. And controlling your risk factors, we sometimes call those the Framingham risk factors, but controlling your cardiovascular disease risk factors, it's important for everybody to do that. But because LP little a is an independent risk factor, it's extremely important for people that have elevated LP little a. I mean, obviously, you're going to get some people in the population that they just say, look, give me a pill. I don't want to change my lifestyle and see what the pill can do for me. But for those folks that are motivated to try to do what they can to minimize their risk, there are a lot of things you can do. And the thing that I would want to emphasize where you get so much bang for the buck in lowering your risk of LP little a would be bringing your weight into the optimal range. And that, I think you would probably concur, Dr. Brewer, that to control insulin resistance, and they're overlapping, obviously, because controlling insulin resistance, you get a lot of bang for the buck there. But when you bring your weight down, you improve your insulin sensitivity, you improve generally most people improve their LDL profile. And you also, for most people, you're gonna improve your blood pressure. Certainly did for me. So you get this huge, all these benefits by doing that. And of course, you know, things like smoking, you know, please don't smoke. And one thing I'll point out, I said my grandpa died at age 52. Obviously, I found out at age 52, I was still alive. One difference, he wasn't overweight, but he smoked. His dad, who died at age 54, he smoked. You know, don't smoke, but if you have world-class LP little a and you have one of these other risk factors, if you smoke, you're a ticking time bomb. Am I wrong to say that, Dr. Burr?
Not at all. Again, that's the point that I've tried to make so many times. Speaking of insulin resistance, let me ask, I don't think you heard me a few minutes ago. What age were your family members again when they had events? 42 and 51? Is that
what? We had, my maternal grandfather was 52. His father was 54. And then there was a cousin. So the grandfather's cousin was actually 44 when he had an event.
So I can tell you this, in my experience, as you know, you're not the only patient that I have with, pardon the term, maybe it's overused, world-class LP little a, I just don't know another term to use for it. Like I've said multiple times, it starts happening at the same age that insulin resistance starts happening. And insulin resistance, by the way, starts happening at the same time that we start having blood pressure problems and at the same time that we start gaining weight. So again, you tend to not see problems in our 20s, and you tend to start seeing problems when our other risk factors start piling up on us. As you've said, managing all those other risk factors, being aware of them and dealing with them is not easy. dealing with insulin resistance is not an easy thing to do. Losing weight's not an easy thing to do until you get the hang of it. But it's very effective at dealing with this risk.
Another thing that, you know, you talk about, the people start having heart attacks when they have elevated Lp(a) in their 40s and 50s, and that does, it certainly correlates when people start with, when people generally start to develop decent levels of insulin resistance. There's some studies being published showing, and if you talk to people who are in the space of treating Lp(a) patients like yourself and Dr. Ronald Krauss, he's a luminary in the lipidology field. He treats a lot of Lp(a) patients. He talks about, and I believe he's published a lot about, small dense LDL particles. He talks about when you get these patients, you know, of course, Lp(a) elevation can increase your hazard ratio, you know, 3 to 4 times. He estimates when you get people that are have those high levels of Lp(a) and then you combine it with small dense LDL, you're talking ticking time bomb, maybe 10 times the hazard ratio. And it's all overlapping, because actually what causes high levels of small dense LDL? High levels of triglycerides. What causes high levels of triglycerides? Insulin resistance and high levels of insulin. You start seeing these studies and you start connecting the dots and you realize, boy, I better get my insulin resistance under control. There's so many independent risk factors that start working together if you don't start controlling the ones that you can control.
Treatments and risk factors. You didn't mention niacin. Did you ever try that?
About 10 years ago, I was on niacin for a couple years to try to lower my LDL. And then a doctor told me that a study came out that showed that it doesn't do any good. And so, and I think we both know that probably he was reading either HP Thrive or Aim High on that. And no, I'm not currently on niacin, but that's an interesting topic. Do you want to talk about that? Or
I've had several people, most of my folks with Lp(a) do take it, and I've had some pretty good results with it. It's certainly something that I would recommend consideration if someone has it. I think the biggest issue that you and I talked about is just the failure of the medical community, including the labs, to screen for this problem. And you coming on board as a patient is very, very helpful to help people begin to be aware and start taking a look. So I'd like to talk with you a minute about the webinar. People don't understand what the webinar is. It's actually a great way to get some access to healthcare that you're just not going to get any other way. You actually get the lab tests yourself for at a local lab, a Quest lab near you, for the inflammation panel and the OGTT and the insulin survey. These are things, inflammation and prediabetes, that your doctor just does not know about. And here's the thing. Harvard Health and many others have said, look, sudden death is not always so sudden. The Hollywood picture that it's a bolt out of the blue is not realistic. It's more like real lightning preceded by clouds, wind, and rain. Stop that metabolic storm before the lightning strikes. And here's where that metabolic storm comes from. It's inflammation, and it has to do usually with prediabetes. So again, we actually get labs, we go over them in the webinar, and then you can start finding out how you can prevent that heart attack others said that you couldn't even predict. We can show you how. Thanks.